Chapter 43, The House That Ted Built. After summer camp, they returned to Butte and moved into a rickety, run-down apartment on Montana Street at Platinum. It was one of four apartments in a two-story house, a broken-down wreck of a place on insecure ground, probably sinking into a mine labyrinth. Their apartment was on the second floor. Ted and Pat couldn't have a washing machine because the landlady was afraid the agitation might shake the whole place down. They couldn't sit in the front room in the winter because the wind whipped through. It was bitter cold. The landlady charged them higher rent than the other tenants, but when she raised the rent on the other tenants, she didn't raise Ted and Pat's rent. That first August, the place really shook. All of Butte shook in the huge 1959 earthquake. It was the largest earthquake to hit Montana, 7.3 on the Richter scale. It killed 28 people, cracked the federal building in Butte, created new geysers in Yellowstone Park, and caused a tremendous avalanche of rocks and timber and dirt that dammed the Madison River and created Quake Lake. It is called the day the mountain fell down. The shaking threw Pat's 7-year-old niece right out of bed. Ted said, "Pops told Ma to quit walking around so heavy. She was shaking the house. Even the earthquake was her fault." I was born a few weeks later. That rickety apartment was my first home. I learned to walk on a kitchen floor with a 6-inch slope. That's quite an incline for a 1-year-old. The first time Mom and Dad had Grandma and Grandpa, Annie and Tony, over for dinner, Mom cooked a beef roast. She didn't know how to cook until she got married. Her mother, who was an excellent cook, gave her a crash course. As Dad started to carve the roast, he gasped. Mom had cooked the beef roast to perfection, a perfect medium. Annie and Tony, with their old country ways, always ate meat well done, worried it was unsafe otherwise. Dad didn't say anything. Grandma and Grandpa didn't say anything. All enjoyed the delicious beef roast. Mom, when we got engaged, Dad and I were making the same annual salary, $5,200 a year. Grandpa, Tony, paid him $100 a week. I made the same annual salary, but I worked 9 months. He worked 12. I was teaching when we got engaged. I didn't teach after we got married. She stayed home and took care of me. Dad worked at the shop selling and painting cars and doing the books. When I was born, they had nothing for me. Grandma, Annie, went to the store with Dad and bought a bassinet. They started saving for a house. The miners had been on strike for 7 weeks when I was born. There was no end in sight. It was bad for everyone. Bad for business, very bad. The strike lasted until February of 1960, a 6-month strike. Mom, we didn't do anything, we didn't go anywhere, we didn't ski or anything. We saved and saved and saved. We didn't have much of an income. We didn't buy anything that wasn't absolutely necessary. A neighbor living behind them froze to death in his house when the fire went out during the night. Mom withdrew her teacher retirement money, and she and Dad used it to buy an empty lot on Princeton Street down on the flat, between the hospital and Whittier Grade School. The lot cost $1,000. Why the lot on Princeton? Mom, it was a good buy. It had a little view of the East Ridge. It was the only empty lot on the block. They bought a kit home from Cap Homes. Dad would build the house himself with help from his brother Joe and friends, and he hired craftsmen. Back then, at least in Butte, when you built your own house, you just built it. You didn't have to get permission from anybody. You didn't have to tell anybody. You just built it. The Cap home cost $10,000. Mom and Dad put 20% down. Cap Homes financed the remaining $8,000. Mom and Dad took out another loan for materials not included in the Cap home. Now they had to save up to have the basement dug and concrete poured. Dad, Pouring the basement wasn't part of the cap home. We didn't borrow money for that. We didn't do anything, just saved our money. Once the basement was dug and the concrete poured, the people from CAP came in and framed the house. It took around 8 hours. Dad, with a CAP home, you got everything. You built it. CAP homes delivered everything on a big semi, so we had to unload it. Was it just me and Joe? Mom, and Tiny West, her brother-in-law, and the two Holmes, friends of Joe. Dad, was Stevie there too? Mom, there were six of you. Yes, Stevie was there, because you said you were going to buy half a keg, and Stevie said, oh, don't be cheap, and you bought the whole keg. I brought ham sandwiches and coleslaw, and you had the beer. Dad, when we got done unloading it, everybody was bombed. We were hauling the windows in, big glass windows. Nothing was broken. One of the men drove home and passed out in the bathtub. After the CAP people framed it, the house was a skeleton. Dad had to do the rest. The walls, the floors, the molding, the windows, the roof. He wired and plumbed it. He spent all his free time building the house. Dad, the molding was oak, hardwood floors, hard to take care of. It was all good quality stuff, all oak. He hired craftsmen to put in the floors and finish the walls. Those walls were perfect, he said. Your mother wanted me to put a picture on it. I couldn't bring myself to put a nail in it. Mom, Dad came home and asked me what colors I'd like the rooms to be. And so I thought and I stewed and I thought this would be nice and we talked it over and we decided on all these colors. And then I had nightmares about what I'd like and stuff like that. What if I picked the wrong colors? It was horrible, horrible. Dad spent about a week masking the windows and oak trim and covering the floor so he wouldn't get paint on them. He worked in the evening and Saturday afternoons. Then Dad and Uncle Joe donned white coveralls and masks, and with the spray guns they used to paint cars, they painted the entire inside of the house white. Me. After you picked all those colors and stewed and worried about it, they painted everything white? Mom, laughing. I was perfectly happy. Why did he put me through that agony? Dad, I thought if she was involved, it took less time to paint the house than to mask everything. Mom, I went down to take them lunch, and the two of them had these masks on. They looked like something from outer space, their coveralls totally covered. It was very exciting. It took 6 months to build the house. Dad, they, the CAP people, said once you move in, you aren't going to do any work on it, and they were right. Mom, something in the laundry room needed some finishing touches, paint or something, and it took Dad another 6 months to do that. They had a rough time making ends meet while building the house. They had to heat both the apartment and the house, so they had two utility bills. Dad, then we had to buy furniture because we were living in a furnished apartment. We had nothing. Me, where did you buy the furniture? Dad, Rosenberg or something on Montana Street. I was in there haggling and haggling. We finally got a price. I said, okay, I don't want to pay for 60 days. The 60 days were up, so I borrowed the money. I said, I don't want my payments to start for 60 days. We were talking about $50 a month. That was a lot of money. I was making $100 a week. This was through the bank, so in the end we got 4 months before I started making any payments. Me, that was everything? Our beds, kitchen table, chairs? Dad, $1,500. The appliances were separate from that, stove, washer, and dryer, and refrigerator. They had to save up to buy all that, too. Dad, we never ate out, did we? Mom, no. They poured through their expenses and couldn't find anything they could cut. Dad, we weren't big spenders, but just the necessities were costing us $115 a week, and Pops paid us $100 a week. I had to go and insist we needed more than what we were being paid. I wound up getting more money for him and Joe. Pops at times wouldn't sign our checks. Not a happy time. He'd taken on return, and he wouldn't sign our checks. How not to treat people. Dad insisted that his father pay him and Uncle Joe an additional $15 a week. Dad did the books. He knew Grandpa could afford it. Grandpa acquiesced. Uncle Joe, Pops would put off giving us our checks if he didn't think we worked hard enough. Our house on Princeton had a front room, kitchen, laundry room, 3 bedrooms, 1 bathroom, all on 1 floor, connected by halls. The houses that my parents grew up in did not have halls. The full basement was unfinished, but plumbed for another bathroom. My earliest memory of being in the house, perhaps my earliest memory of anything, we had just moved in. I stepped onto the side porch, still holding onto the screen door, which didn't have a catch yet. A gust of wind blew the door back against the house and took me with it. I flew off the porch and landed in gravel. The cement for the sidewalk had not yet been poured. I remember flying off the porch but not landing. I was fine. My parents weren't, but they recovered. It was to be a red brick house, but it took another year to save up for the bricks. In the meantime, Dad said with a grin, we lived in a tar paper shack. Mom and Dad splurged one evening and went to see Dr. Zhivago. It was winter and snowing. When they returned home, the house looked like Varenko, completely white, the tar paper acting like flypaper catching the snowflakes. When they saved enough for the bricks, Dad hired bricklayers to do that. In the end, we had a beautiful red brick house. For the lawn, Dad bought sod, which was the only way to have a lawn in that cold climate. One day, Dad saw workmen tearing down Blonde Edna's brothel, which was about a block from the shop. He stopped the car, pointed at the bushes, and asked, what are you going to do with those? Throw them out. Could you throw them in my truck instead? Sure. Dad returned to the shop and came back with a truck. The workmen threw the bushes into the truck. Those were the bushes in our front yard. As for the first house that Uncle Joe built, Joe said, we weren't making much money. I'd go buy a wreck and work on it and sell it. When Helen and I first got married, I always thought I wouldn't have any money, so if I wanted a house, I'd have to build it. I had my pilot's license. I'd usually fly every weekend to build up my hours. It dawned on me, I shouldn't be doing this. I have a family. By chance, I looked in the newspaper. Those lots were on sale for $400. I asked my mother if she had the $400, and she said, yeah, and gave it to me. Joe considered it a loan. And then a guy across the street came over. His name was Dave Jensen. He said, what are you doing? And I said, I'm building a house. And he said, go see Burke McDonald at Largy Lumber. I said, what do I do when I see him? He said, don't worry about it. Just go ahead and tell him what you want to do. I told him, I've got the land. Burke said to me, how much money you got, kid? I had $300 in my pocket. I said, I got $100. I gave him the money, and he said, go to it, kid. What I did is I paid him maybe $10 or $15 a month as I was buying the materials. I had no plan of what I was doing. The next guy that come up said, what are you doing? I said, I'm going to build a house. Why don't you go ahead and help me with it? He said, Joe, if I help you with this, I tell you what I'm going to do. I'll come over here every evening after work and tell you what to do. I can't work on it. I'll tell you what you have to do. I'm going to charge you $2 an hour. I said, that's fine. That's how I learned to do the carpentry work. He'd say, you cut the wood this way and tomorrow I'll tell you what to do. So I got a crash course. In the end, Joe paid him $200. I was taking Helen to church one day. I saw one of my friends. We used to ride motorcycles. I saw him digging a hole. I said, what are you doing? He said, he's building a basement so we can live there while he's building the house. It dawned on me, that's a good idea. I built a garage to begin with and then built the house. Joe built the garage such that he could paint a car in it, just in case things took a bad turn. They lived in the garage while he built the house. Yeah, it's really strange how it all turned out, Joe said. For my mother to give me the $400, which was probably the only $400 she had, It worked out really well. My in-laws paid for the concrete. That was nice. That was remarkable. Just luck again, as I call it. Got that house built. We got the Edsel dealership around the same time I finished building the house. When I got the woodwork done, I had to start plumbing. I had to learn how to plumb. I bought one of those books, Electrical and Plumbing. Then I went down to the place where all the warehouses are. I don't know how I ran across these guys. They had a shed. They were selling all the plumbing stuff I needed. I said, I'm building a house. I need plumbing and electricity items. I can pay you $10 a week for that. I had a loan to pay for it at 4%. Even my father gave me $2,000. I went to pay him back and he said, what's that? That's the money you loaned me. Joe mortgaged the house and used the money to pay back his parents. Those were the only people I had to pay out of that loan. It was about the same time we got the Edsel. I felt pretty lucky in all that stuff. Starting out from scratch without that help, I don't know where I would have gotten the money from. So that worked out all right. After finishing their homes, Dad and Uncle Joe offered to build a new house for their parents. Grandpa said, no, this house is fine. House in old country had dirt floor. This house is fine. When Grandma and Grandpa's house needed a new roof, Dad and Uncle Joe shingled it. They replaced the wood stove in the kitchen with an electric stove, which made life easier for Grandma. But when Grandpa came home and saw it, he was not happy. How would you feel if I came in and did this in your house? He said. It was a nice gesture, but as Joe said, we should have asked first. Sometime in between finishing college and having me, Dad taught Mom to drive. She'd never had a car. She got around town on the bus or walked. When she was a teenager and worked at the funeral home, sometimes the boss gave her a ride home in the hearse. What will the neighbors think? Her mother said. We moved into our house on Princeton in January of 1962. My brother Jeff was born in March. Mom was afraid to pick him up because he was so thin. He weighed only 5 pounds. Back then, mother stayed in the hospital for several days after delivering babies. The babies were kept in the nursery. Snooky's daughter had a baby born premature while Mom was in the hospital with Jeff. I went back to the nursery, Mom said. He, Snooky's grandchild, was 2 pounds or something. I was looking through the window, and here's this tiny baby, about this big, scooting with his heel up the bed. I don't know how he could do that. I couldn't believe it. He was little, but he was tough. He survived just fine. I was 2 years old when we moved from the dilapidated apartment on Montana Street to our lovely new house on Princeton. I had slept in the crib in the apartment. Dad took me by the hand. I don't remember this. Mom told me. And asked, do you want to sleep in this bed? Pointing to the big bed. Or this one? Pointing to the crib. I picked the big bed. As I learned to talk, Dad recognized that pronouncing Leskovar was difficult for a little one. He came up with the idea that we call our grandparents Grandma L for Leskovar and Grandma T for Thompson. I only had one grandpa, Grandpa L, since Mom's father died when she was little. I called him Grandpa. When Jeff was little, he called him Pom Pom. My memories of life on Princeton are idyllic. There were 27 children on our block. Dad called it Fertile Valley. Every December, Dad pulled us on the sled into the forest with Mom walking alongside. He'd cut down a tree for Christmas. To be a child in my family meant to be cared for and loved, to be protected, to feel safe and secure, loved. My only worry was of that big black dog chasing me, or I feared would chase me, or chase me in a dream, whose fierceness was probably more imaginary than real. It was a safe, peaceful existence. Our well-being was paramount. People came before things, and among people, family came first. When I started losing baby teeth and the tooth was loose but still attached, I'd scurry across the street to the Burt's, and Peggy, the neighborhood nurse, would pull it out. One day I was playing outside in the dirt and walked into the kitchen and announced to Mom that I had put pebbles in my nose. Mom called her sister, who was a nurse. "What do I do?" Mom said. "I'll be right over," Auntie Isla said. She fished the pebbles out of my nose with tweezers. I was 4 when I started kindergarten. Mom walked with me the first few times to be sure I knew the way, and then she let me walk by myself. Dad couldn't believe a child that small could walk the few blocks to school by herself. He followed me in the car. I only learned that a few years ago. The next year, I attended St. Anne's School, where Mom had gone. There were 100 first graders split into two classes, 50 children in each classroom. Sister Mary Alvin taught all 50 of us to read. She divided us into 3 groups based on reading level. I was in the middle group until Mom and Dad took me out of school for a week to go skiing at Sun Valley. Mom tutored me during that week. Right after that, I came home from school and told Mom, "Sister said I'm a cookie." Sister Mary Albert had moved me to the cookie group, the most advanced readers. As for second grade and up, St. Anne's practiced the ungraded primary for reading. All the children took reading at the same time and went to the room based on their reading level. Precocious children weren't bored. Children who struggled received the instruction they needed. We carpooled to and from school with the neighbor kids and went home for lunch. Sometimes Mr. Mazzolini picked us up in the cement truck. We'd pile into the cab of the truck. It seemed normal to ride home in a cement truck. It also seemed normal to visit the neighborhood taxidermist. Often we went for a Sunday drive, sometimes along Harding Way, to the cheese place in Whitehall. I can still taste the Gouda. We listened to Monitor on the radio on the way home. Grandpa went to the shop every day. On Sundays, when they were closed, he practiced his bassoon in the showroom. When Uncle Joe asked why he practiced there, he said, "Very good acoustics. It helps me hear the notes really well." I bet the best part of the acoustics was that Grandma wasn't yelling at him. One Sunday, Dad stopped at the shop to put gas in the car. They had their own gas pump. Some guy walked up and told Dad he couldn't do that on a Sunday. Dad was furious. It was his own gas pump. Grandpa was practicing his bassoon in the showroom and saw what was going on and walked out and calmed Dad down. Gas stations couldn't open on Sundays unless they were open 24 hours a day. There were only 2 such gas stations in Butte. One was in a seedy part of town. When they had a pump replaced at the shop, a teamster drove the plumber to the shop. When it was lunchtime, another teamster came and drove the plumber to where he ate lunch. He couldn't eat his lunch at the job. Then another teamster took the plumber back to finish the job. Union rules dictated that the shop close by 4:30 on weekdays, except sales, which could stay open until 6. They could sell cars on Saturdays, but only until 1 o'clock. They were closed on Sundays. Dad moonlighted selling World Book encyclopedias. He rose to be the area manager. One evening, Dad went to a radio station party after work. A thank you for the advertisers. Dad was a beer drinker, but they were serving double martinis. The party went late into the evening. Dad drove home and staggered from the car to the house. He went straight to the bathroom. Mom found him hugging the toilet. "I'm so ashamed, I'm so ashamed," he said. "What if the children see me?" We were in bed. The next day, Mom had a hair appointment and hired a babysitter. Dad decided to stay home and nurse his hangover. He told Mom since he was home, no need for the sitter. When the refrigerator repairman came to the door, my brother Jeff, who was a toddler, answered the door and said, "I'm babysitting my dad." Then one of the people he was training to sell World Book came to the door. Seeing what bad shape Dad was in, he said he'd come back another day. Dad swore off doubles. People thought it was fun to get their guests roaring drunk, knowing they'd be driving home. It was a different time. He was so pathetic, Mom said, laughing as she told me the story. That's the only time that happened. Had it been a recurring event, it wouldn't have been funny. Dad kept a bottle of Hennessy cognac in the house for Grandpa. Mom and Dad hired an elderly lady to babysit me and my brother when they went out. She was always very quiet when they arrived, but when Mom and Dad came home, she talked and talked and talked. One evening, when Grandma and Grandpa were over for dinner, Dad poured a glass of Hennessy for Grandpa and noticed the very expensive bottle was short. "What happened?" he asked Mom after they left. She said, "I'm not drinking it. The children aren't drinking it." He marked the bottle. He marked all the bottles. The next time the quiet, then talkative babysitter babysat, he checked the bottles. Sure enough, she'd been tippling quite a bit while she was supposed to be watching us. She didn't drink the cheap stuff. She drank the Hennessy. Needless to say, they never had her babysit again. Dad, when we went over for dinner, Pops might be there, he might not. He wanted everybody there, whether he showed up or not. When they came to our house for dinner, if Pops was ready to go and Ma wasn't, he'd leave, and I'd end up taking Ma home. Grandma Elle still loved to watch the opera on the radio, The Voice of Firestone, which featured performances from the Metropolitan Opera. She watched the Lawrence Welk show on TV. She whistled through her teeth and tapped her leg in time to the music. She watched the fight of the week. Her young grandson, Joey, would sit and watch with her as she shadowboxed during the fight. They ate Hershey bars and drank beer. She gave Joey a pony, which is a tiny beer. She'd say, "We're going to the market, and once there, go get the buggy." And she took her pocketbook. She didn't call it a purse. She knitted and crocheted. It seems she was always busy. She liked to read fashion magazines. Grandma was captivated by all things European, except Grandpa. Despite their fights and bickering, one thing Grandma Al and Grandpa could agree on was to go on a picnic. Grandma would call Uncle Joe and Dad and say, "We're going on a picnic." For the picnic, she cooked a beef roast with carrots, onions, green peppers, and potatoes. She put the lid on the roasting pan, wrapped it with layers of kitchen towels to keep it warm. They'd bring salami and Swiss cheese and French bread and red wine and beer. We'd drive up to Elk Park and look for a good spot in the forest. If we saw anyone, we moved. Too crowded. The first time Dad went on a picnic in a park in Seattle with his brother Eddie's family, there were people sitting right next to them. He was horrified. Grandpa would find some shade, stretch out on a lawn chair, and take a nap, content in the knowledge that his family was around him. There's an old saying, well, if there isn't, there should be. Don't let Grandma brush your hair when she's mad at Grandpa. It seems Grandma was always mad at Grandpa. I don't remember her ever saying a civil word to him. He muttered in reply. When we came back from Elk Park, she'd usher me into the bathroom. I'd lean my head over the bathtub, and she would brush my hair with such vigor I thought she'd scalp me. She was trying to dislodge any ticks that might have dropped into my hair during our picnic in the forest. That is one of my most vivid memories of my childhood. Not the picnics, but Grandma vigorously brushing my hair over the bathtub. I don't remember ever seeing a tick. Dad remembers her finding ticks in his hair when he was a boy. She'd drop them on the stove and they'd sizzle.